Today in the news, we've got some AMD, some pixels, and some canaries. What's up guys, I'm Snows, and this is your boot sequence. Let's get started with AMD. With Dr. Lisa Su opening at Computex this year, it's safe to say that we'll have plenty of new things to discuss. But Computex is in 7 weeks, and waiting is pretty boring, isn't it? So let's talk about what could happen prior. According to Cal Cotland, AMD is going to have a private meeting on the 23rd of April with some partners to discuss more details about upcoming products, including their Ryzen 3000 and Navi graphics. As we've seen many times, like for example, with the GTX 1660 Ti, we're likely to get some leaks out of this event. In fact, those private events often are very similar to the main presentation that we see in big events, so we should probably expect some solid info out of it. I'm definitely going to keep an eye out for that. Besides that, AMD revealed its latest Ryzen Pro Mobile and Athlon Pro Mobile processors today. Skimming on the specs, the Ryzen 7 and 5 Pro will offer 4 cores and 8 threads, while Ryzen 3 Pro offers 4 cores and 4 threads. The Athlon Pro is left with 2 cores and 4 threads. They all have 6 MB of cache, and while the clock speeds vary quite a bit, the other difference is in the GPU cores, with the Athlons offering 3 Vega cores, and the Ryzen 3, 5, and 7 offering 6, 8, and 10 Vega cores respectively. The clock speeds of the GPUs also change quite a bit. All in all, they're the exact same as their non-pro counterparts, except for the enhanced security and longer warranty. On the other hand, 3 new unknown CPUs have popped up in the 3DMark database. It was spotted by Tum Apisak, and they are the AMD RX 8125, RX 8120, and A9-9820. The processors with the RX prefix are likely embedded processors with 8 cores and 8 threads, something similar to what you would see on the Udoo Bolt that was kickstarted last year. As for the A9-9820, it's likely a laptop APU, but this time with 8 cores and 8 threads. I assume that they all come with some sort of Vega integrated graphics, but no specifics have been leaked on that. I'm guessing we might learn more about these after the partner event. Moving on, it looks like the Google Play Store just gave us our first look at the next Pixel devices. The phones that we thought would be called the Pixel 3 Lite is actually the Pixel 3a and a variant called the Pixel 3a XL, at least according to the Play Store leak. Strangely enough, the rumors around the 3a shows that it is a pretty good alternative to the Pixel 3. It has a slightly larger screen at 5.6 inches, the same 4 GB of RAM, the same battery, and apparently will have a headphone jack. That's real nice. The biggest difference is the CPU, sporting a Snapdragon 670 instead of the 845. The camera is said to be the same, although we don't know for sure if it will carry the extremely powerful Pixel Visual Core. The XL version might sport a little bit of a better processor, maybe the Snapdragon 710, but no info on that. Oh, and no notches, definitely a bonus. The launch seems to be imminent since the name of the phone actually popped up on Google's website a few days ago. Next up, if you wanted to try out the Chromium-based Edge browser last week but didn't want to download it from unofficial channels, you can now download a preview of it directly from Microsoft. I did it and it works just fine. Right now, there isn't a dark mode available, but your version will stay updated as they come in. You can download the dev channel version, which is updated weekly, or even the canary version, which is updated daily. Microsoft also made a list of all of the things that they either replaced or turned off from Chromium. I think it's pretty cool that Microsoft allows us to try it out like that so early. Next up in gaming, Tencent just released their own game launcher. Damn it, another one. It's not actually 100% new. They're basically rebranding their Chinese Tencent gaming platform called WeGame into WeGame X. Very original, I know. It's in early access right now and it's pretty bare bones, offering only around 17 games in total. Now, honestly, I hate it. I don't want another game launcher, I'm done with that. But I don't have any problems with Tencent actually going forwards with this. In my comment section, I often see people going off on Tencent and painting it as this evil corporation. And by proxy, they absolutely hate Epic Games since Tencent owns a 40% share in it. But keep in mind that Tencent has shares in pretty much touch everything gaming. They own Riot Games, have shares in Ubisoft, Activision Blizzard, Snapchat, Take-Two, Supercell, and more. They're basically just a huge investor in the gaming industry. So if you want to take a stand against them, don't just limit yourself to Epic Games. Anyways, guys, that is pretty much it for the news. Hopefully you've enjoyed. If you have any questions, don't forget to drop them in the comment section down below. As usual, you can click right here to see the latest video, right here to subscribe to the channel. A like would be also greatly appreciated. Stay frosty, and I'll see you guys on the next one.